Hello, everyone. My name is Dwayne Kimball, owner and founder of KMD89 Consulting, Leave No Vet Behind. I'm bringing you another video today, but it's not going to be a specific topic as it pertains to the VA disability compensation claims process. Today, I'm going to talk about my personal experience with the VA claims process. Now, you may ask yourself, why is my experience any different than another vet? Today, I'm going to be talking about my personal experience from a rater standpoint. That's right, a rater standpoint. When I worked for the Department of Veterans Affairs before I retired, I was a rater, rating specialist, RVSR, either one of those names if you're familiar with service connection. So what that means, I was the one that either denied or granted benefits, and I wrote the rating decisions, denying or granting those benefits. So therefore, I want to just do a video about my personal experience and some of the ups and downs that I went through as it pertains to my claim. And I would first start by saying the first issue that I had was when I was stationed in Fort Hood, Texas. I'm an Army veteran. When I was stationed at Fort Hood, Texas, and I was ETSing out of the military. And I went to the troop medical clinic when I was clearing. And at that time, no one told me about VA disability compensation benefits, my sleep apnea, my low back pain, my flat feet, none of that. And when I get to the troop medical clinic, I see another soldier that I was stationed with while I was in Germany. He was a comeback medic. And I'm going through and I'm filling out my paperwork. And he says, you know, on your exit exam, don't mark yes to any having any injuries. If you do that, they're going to hold you over a couple of days and do an exam. So I didn't want to stay any longer than what I had to. So I checked no on everything. That was the first mistake that I made. I should have taken the time to check yes and listed all the conditions or injuries from service. So that was my first mistake. Secondly, years later, I went years without knowing that I could even receive treatment or get compensation from the VA. About a year before I hired on with the VA, I was working for a private company, and another gentleman that was prior military, I think he was a Coast Guard. We were talking one day, he said, are you a vet? I said, yeah. He says, well, are you getting your compensation benefits? And I was like, well, what's that? And he explained it to me, and I was like, no, I'm not. And he's like, did you get injured while on active duty? And I was like, yeah, I did, but I never filed a claim. So I kind of blew it off, didn't think too much of it. About a year later, I found myself working at the VA. And then the second day on the job, one of my coworkers was hired or got promoted to a rating specialist, asked me, was I a veteran? I said, yes. And she said, are you getting compensated for the injuries you sustained while on active duty? And I said, no, I'm not. And she said, well, at lunchtime, you know, we'll come back in the training room and I'll help you put your claim in. And I was like, yes. I was like, fine, cool. So the first question I did ask, well, what am I entitled to claim? And she responded by claim everything that you were seen for in service and everything that's hurting right now. And I was like, okay. So I just start listing conditions from service and conditions after service. Well, as the days went on, I found out half of the things that she said that I could claim, I wasn't going to get service connected for because they didn't fall under the five ways of service connection. And I did another video. I'll posted down in the description about the five different ways of service connection. So I got some bad information from this particular individual, but I knew going forward that the conditions that didn't fall within the five ways of service connection, I wasn't going to get service connected for. So I was okay with that because I didn't meet the criteria. So I filed a claim in June of 09. I didn't get my first compensation and pension exam until March 2010. So during that time, I had been writing for almost a year now, and I was out of training, and I was writing rating decisions, and I had got to the point to where I was comfortable making decisions or denying or approving veterans' disability claims. So I go to my first comp and pen exam, and even the items that conditions I was treated for in service, they didn't schedule an exam for me. And I was confused because I was like, well, wait a minute. I looked through my medical records, and according to the VA regulation, I was treated for these conditions while on active duty, so I was eligible to claim them. But before I go any further about the compensation and pension exam, about 4 months into training, I got into a van pool. We were all commute to work, and I was the only new person in a van pool. Everybody else that was working for the VA had been there already, you know, 5, 6, 7, you know, almost 10 years. And I would hear all these horror stories about them saying, you know, having all this type of issue with their claim, they're having this type of issue with their claim. And I'm like, well, I'm in, you know, training to become a raider, so, you know, who better to learn or know about this process than me, because I'm the one that's making decisions. So I'm like, I'm going to make sure that doesn't happen to me, because I'm doing this every day. I'm denying and approving claims, and I'm going to be good. That could be far from the truth. Like I said, when I went to my first comp and pen exam, I found out that half the things that I was treated for in service and I claimed, they didn't schedule an exam. So I go to the exam and I ask the doctor, he says, okay, you're here for X, Y, and Z. And I asked him, I said, well, what about the other conditions that I claim? He said, well, I don't have any control over that. That the request came from the regional office, and this is what only I'm supposed to evaluate you on today. So now I'm curious. I'm like, why didn't they schedule other things, conditions that I claim? So I go through the exam, the comp and pen doctor, he was really nice. I don't think he was a retired ranger, but he was a ranger in the Army, really nice, super nice, explained some things to me. I get through the exam, and I can remember walking back to my car in the parking lot, and I'm like, why didn't they schedule me for these other conditions that I was treated for in service? So now I can only wait. I waited about a month and a half, and I get a rating decision in June 2010. And I get it, and they were like approved for five different conditions, and everything else they denied. And they were like, oh, you weren't treated in service for this, you weren't treated in service for that. And I'm like, wait a minute. The regulation states that if you obtain an injury, treat it, show a complaint or diagnosis in service, you get a comp and pen exam. So I knew that regulation, and I'm like, I'm looking through my medical records, and I see these other conditions. So now the fight begins, because I have to fight with another raider in another state that was telling me no. And I'm like, we received the same training. Bare minimum, I should have been given a comp and pen exam, and it should have been up to the examiner of the state provide a medical opinion if it is least or less likely than not that the conditions I'm claiming were due to service. So now the fight begins. So I'm going back, and I get copies of more of my records from the VA, and I'm going through them, and I file another claim. And I go to another comp and pen exam. And by this time, you know, I'm getting very knowledgeable. It's been over a year. I'm on what they call signal signature now. I didn't have to have anybody to review my work. So I was just rating and deciding claims on my own. I still had help. I could reach out to people to ask questions. So I go to my second comp and pen exam. And this examiner was not like my first one. I go in and he asked me, I was claiming lower back pain, and he asked me, were all you people naturally big? And I was confused by this statement and shocked. So I knew right there and then that it wasn't going to be a favorable decision on anything that he was evaluating me for that day. So I left very upset, very mad about a comment that he made. And I said, well, instead of me appealing this issue, because I knew he was going to say that it wasn't due to service. I said, instead of me appealing this issue, let me wait to get the rating decision, which I had to do, to see what negative opinion he was going to give me. So he gave me a negative opinion. But one thing I did do, since I did the exam at the VA, I went to the release of information office at the VA and got a copy of that exam so I could see exactly what that examiner stated. And he put a lot of false information on that exam. He stated that he asked me certain questions and I gave him a reply, which was incorrect. Some things that he did ask me, but there was a lot of things that he didn't not ask me. And I found that out because I obtained a copy from the release of information, which you are entitled to have a copy. So if you have a comp and pen exam at a VA medical center, you can go to release of information about, you know, maybe 3 to 7 days after the CMP exam and get a copy of it right there. So that way you can see if the examiner gave you a positive, a negative opinion. So after I got that exam, I knew he was going to deny me for those conditions that I was given a comp and pen. So in the interim, I typed up a letter or email, and I sent it to the director of the VA Medical Center that I had the comp and pen, and I filed a formal complaint against him. So we go back and forth. I receive a letter. They say they're looking into it, and I said, well, they told me I should appeal that rating decision. And I was very adamant that I shouldn't have to appeal something because he gave me an insufficient exam. And I gave them the regulation, the VA regulation, of the criteria of an insufficient exam. So make a long story short, I went back. I got another CMP exam about maybe 6 months later. And I requested there be a different examiner because I didn't want the same person that I had filed a formal complaint against to give me the same evaluation. And the VA honored that, and I got another examiner, and it was a positive opinion this time around. But I hear so many vets that they don't go and get a copy of the comp and pen exam, and they don't know why the doctor said no. And that's very important. If you do a comp and pen exam at the VA, you definitely want to get a copy of that exam. So by this time, you know, I'm filing multiple claims, going back and forth and back and forth. And the regional office that was handling my claim, they were like, no, no, no. And they were giving me, I was getting service connected for some stuff, but I didn't feel that the valuations or the percentage was the correct percentage. And now I'm in a deeper fight. I'm feeling that the VA has turned their back on me. I'm probably like 2 or 3 years into working my claim. And I remember calling the area office. The area office for my region was in Nashville, Tennessee. And I said, hey, this particular regional office that's handling my claim, they're providing fraudulent rating decisions. So I had to give an explanation of why. And I'm like, I'm finding multiple errors. I shouldn't have to appeal this stuff because it's not only me, it's, you know, some of my coworkers. You know, they complain about some of the same things. Somebody need to look in this. And I keep complaining to them and complaining to them. And during that time, when I was complaining to the area office in Nashville, I was getting denied for some things, but I was also getting service connected for some things. And on my third phone call, an email with them, one of the representatives states, well, you need to go talk to your management at your location. I'm like, well, what they have to do with my claim? They can't even see it. So they say, no, 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 you have to go and you have to talk to management. So I went and talked to my immediate supervisor, who in turn I had to go talk to her immediate supervisor, which was an AVSM, Assistant Veteran Service Center Manager. And I talked to him, and he was like, oh, yeah, I know somebody in the office. I have them look into it, yada, yada, yada. That fell on deaf ears. Never heard anything back. So by this time, I'm like, okay, I'm going to escalate it to the director of my regional office. So I sent her an email, make an appointment. I go in and talk to her. It was about maybe a 10 or 15 minute conversation. There was no response from her. I did all the talking. It was basically when I walked in the office and I started talking, I introduced myself and I started talking. She just had this deer in the headlight look, like, I don't really care. And nothing ever came of it. So I have a meeting with both of those managers, and I call the area office back, and I'm like, hey, this is what happened. And I told them, I said, you know, the first manager, nothing came of it. The director, she had a deer in the headlight look. So I think the area office, they did some, you know, maybe call the regional office that was handling my claim and told them my concerns, and, you know, I got a rating decision, and it was where I felt it should be at, but it was some other things that were still outstanding. And they're telling me, okay, by this time you got to file an appeal. So before I filed an appeal, I got to thinking, how can I get a faster response from appeals so it's not sitting in an appeals department for 5 or 6 years? Because back then, claims settled on appeals for 5, 6, 7 years. So I said, okay. I said, well, let me understand how this appeal process works. And someone told me, well, when you file an appeal, you can ask for a decision review officer hearing once your appeal gets certified. And I'm like, well, how long does that take? They said about 60 days. So I asked for a decision review officer's hearing, a video hearing, because the regional office, that appeal team that was handling my appeal, was in another state. So I filed the appeal, tell them what I felt, what was wrong. I think I had the evaluation percentage was incorrect and the effective date was incorrect. So filed an appeal, and I filed an appeal December 2014. That's when I filed it, December 2014. And come September, I didn't get a response about them scheduling a hearing. And I was sitting there, I was waiting and waiting, and I kept dragging my feet. I was like, oh, I'll email them tomorrow, I'll call tomorrow. And now we're in November 2015. And I email the appeals team and I say, hey, I haven't heard anything. It's about 9 o'clock that morning. And about 2 o'clock PM, I get an email back saying, your hearing is next week. And I was like, okay. So I get to the hearing, I had a representative and he said, hey, Dwayne, I'm just gonna introduce us. You know more about these hearings than I do. You facilitate them at the rater level. So I'm just gonna introduce us and you go into the hearing. And that's what we did. So I go to the hearing and I'm talking. And one thing I did, I think that really helped me, was I kept a copy of my claim folder. And what I mean by that, everything that I sent to the VA and everything the VA sent me, I kept a copy of. And I still have it, and I'll show you. Give me 1 second. Okay, so as you can see, this is my, it's not my actual claim form. It's just a copy. So everything that I sent the VA and the VA sent me, I kept a copy of it. And it came in handy in the hearing because I was appealing an effective date. And an effective date that they gave me, they were supposed to go back, I think, 2 years, about 28 months. And they were like, no, we don't see it. I'm like, it's in my file. So in the video conference, the Dro asked me, she said, well, how did you get the claims folder? I said, well, this is just a copy of what you have. I just made sure everything that the VA sent me and I sent them, I made a copy. So you definitely, you know, you want to do that. So you'll have your own record. And she says, I reviewed your file and I don't see where we should go back for this effective date. So I'm sitting there, and as you can see, I don't know if you can see down here at the bottom, the little tabs, they're pink, orange. And before I went in the hearing, I tabbed everything, okay? So I knew exactly where everything should be in my folder. So once I tabbed everything, I'm going through and I'm telling her, keep going down. And I was like, it's behind a letter dated July 19, 2012, something like that. She keep going down, I don't see it, keep going. And she was like, oh, there it is. So they never went back in my file to see exactly the document I was telling them that they should have used that particular effective date, okay? But if I didn't have a copy of that, I went ahead and had a leg to stand on when I went into my appeal. So just having that information and other information, and especially the copy of my claim folder, I came out of the appeal and I was awarded everything that I appealed. I won my appeal and I won it in less than 12 months, okay? I know some people have probably done maybe 10, but I was dragging my feet a while, but I won it in 10 months, largely because I had a copy of my entire claim file. I knew the dates when I appealed it. I had everything written down, dates, the document number that I submitted it on, and I had my copy of my claim file. I had it tabbed. So that definitely was a plus. And I get a rating decision probably, I want to say, December 2015, granting me everything. But I still had a couple more claim conditions that weren't on appeal that was at the rating activity level, okay? So I'm going through and I'm going through, and by this time, I'm maybe at three and a half years rating, and I'm very comfortable, and by this time, I'm very knowledgeable in the, of the VA claims process, but I was still learning. But I had enough information at that time to be successful with my claim. So I go and I get a rating decision, and they tell me no, and I'm like, wait a minute, that's not right. So I said, well, I'm not going to fight with them. I'm just going to do another appeal like I did before. So I did a second appeal, and I won that appeal in 6 months, even quicker than the first one, largely because I had a little bit more knowledge, I had a copy of my claims file, and I knew exactly how to word my appeal. So I was sitting in, I think I was in the Dallas airport. I went on a family vacation and was checking my email, and I was like, wow, I won my appeal. And I was like, you gotta be kidding me, And then I thought, I was like, man, it took me 4 years as a rating specialist because another rating specialist kept telling me no. And I was familiar with the process. So then I thought, well, what about veterans that don't work for the VA or don't have the knowledge or education as pertains to the VA claims process? And from that day forth, I always considered myself as a liberal rater. And anybody that had a claim come across my desk, they were 100% until they weren't 100%, meaning, if the criteria or they only met the criteria for 80%, then they would only get service connected for 80 or 10 or whatever that number it was. But I always looked at everybody could get 100%, not saying that everybody could, but that's just the way I looked at it personally. But had a lot of ups and downs, a lot of frustration as it pertains to my claim. At one point, I even felt that that the VA turned their back on me just because some of the competent pen examiners that I had, two really good ones, and then the last two, they were horrible. They were bad. They were really bad. And that's when another thing that helped me was the VA came out with these disability benefit questionnaires, and I did a video about disability benefit questionnaires, and I'll share that in the link as well. So after those last two company pen exams with those horrible VA examiners, I went to the VA's website, printed off DBQs, and I found doctors that will complete those DBQs for me. And I found three, and they were very helpful. They were very veteran friendly, and a couple of them I had been receiving treatment for, so that definitely was a plus because I had been receiving treatment for like a year or two with them. But you know, that's not a standard. It's not a requirement that you have to be receiving treatment for them to complete a DBQ. It just so happened that these two doctors were my doctors before I even went to the VA. So that was a plus for me. And I started submitting those. And the last DBQ that I submitted, it was for an increase in my migraines. So I go to my primary care physician, my private doctor, not my primary care physician at the VA. And I asked him, you know, hey, will you be willing to complete this DBQ? Miss a lot of work due to migraines. And I knew that would I met the criteria for 50%. So he completes the DBQ. I submit it. And I get a call from QTC. And the lady tells me that the VA, the regional office, has scheduled me for a neurological exam concerning my claim increase of my migraines. And I said, well, ma'am, I said, I submitted a DBQ, a disability benefit questionnaire, and you know, it's filled out correctly, and I shouldn't have to go to see your doctor. And she proceeds to tell me, well, no, your private doctor can't complete a DBQ. So I was shocked by that because a private physician can complete a DBQ. And I asked her, I said, can you give me the regulation that states that my doctor can't? And she said she didn't have it in front of her. I asked for an email, and I was actually in the regulation while I was talking to her on the phone. I was in the M21. So I get a copy of the regulation that states that private providers can complete DBQs, and I emailed it to her. And she says, oh, I didn't know that. And I'm like, well, why would you tell me that if you didn't know that? And how many other vets have you told that? And she says, well, what do you want me to do? And I said, well, that 2507 request, medical request you got from the region office, I want you to put a note in there and state that the veteran is refusing an exam and states that he does not want there to be any medical conflict of medical evidence in his claim file. Please forward his claim to the rating activity, ready to rate / RFD. She did that. I turned around and called the VA 800 number, 800-827-1000. And the representatives that you talk to are not raters, but they are VSRs, Veteran Service Representatives. And what they do, they gather all the information and give it to the rating board or rating specialist, like someone like myself that I used to do for the VA, and they make the decision. So I'm telling her that, hey, I don't know why this exam was scheduled. I have a, you know, one is the DBQ in my claim, electronic claim folder. She said, yes. And I said, okay, I just got a call from QTC saying that I have an exam. And I told her the conversation. And she says, well, maybe the rating specialist just wanted to know something. Well, at this time, she knew that I worked for the VA. But at this time, I had already retired, but my claim was still sensitive 7. So what that means is when you're sensitive 7, no other VA employee at your location can look at your file. It's at another location, and VA employees at that location is only a handful of people that have that has access to look at your file. So she says, well, maybe the rating specialist just wanted to know something. So I told her, I said, well, can you look in VBMS in my notes in my electronic claim folder and see if the rating specialist put any notes? And I think she was shocked because when I said VBMS, and that's VBMSR, and that's the program that raters use to complete these rating decisions. So she looked, she said, nope, there's no notes. I said, well, can you look in the deferral tab So like I was saying, I asked her to look in VBMS and see if the rater deferred back to the VSR for additional development. And she said no. And I asked, well, why would you tell me? Maybe they just want to, they may want to just see something. That's incorrect information. I was like, well, can you put that I called in? Can you put in my notes that I called in and I requested that my claim be sent to the rating activity, ready to rate RFD due to the fact that I had a disability benefit questionnaire from my private physician. So she said yes, and literally a week later, about a week, week and a half later, I received a rating decision in the mail granting the increase for my service-connected migraines. But again, you know, luckily for me, I was educated on the process and was able to navigate through all this red tape to maximize my benefit. So, and that was it. That was the last claim that I filed with the VA, and I was successful. So I wanted to just share that story with you. I hope some things kind of resonated with you or, you know, caught your attention, because I know there are a lot of veterans out there that are very frustrated. A lot of my clients, they have a lot more horror stories than mine, instances that they ran into with the VA, and that, you know, a lot of times we just felt like giving up. But again, I wanted to share that story with you because at the time, like I said earlier, I was working my claim. I was a rating specialist, so I was telling you about my personal experience at, with the VA disability compensation process from a rating specialist standpoint. So with that being said, please like the video, please subscribe, and hit that notification button so you can get notified of more videos that I upload. And also leave a comment. And you know, if you leave a comment, you know, let me know what you liked about it or what you didn't like about it, and if you had some of the same experiences that I had. So with that being said, you know, please go to my website. It's www.kmd89.com. That's www.kmd89.com. On there I have a list of my services. And also, if you want me to do a specific video on a particular topic, leave it in the comment or go to my website and send me an email, and I'll definitely get around to doing that video. So with that being said, I would like to thank you for watching this video, and thank you for your service. And if you have a claim pending or you're thinking about doing a claim, please feel free to reach out. And if not, you know, good luck. But by all means, if you have any questions, feel free to email me. Thank you.